Good evening. I'd like to tell you a story about a couple who reached the American dream in 2007. They retired. They did everything they were supposed to do. They had a house that they paid off, about a $400,000 house. They had $1 million sitting in their 401k, and they were getting Social Security. And so life was good. So let's fast forward to 2009. The same couple now had a house that was worth $200,000. Their 401k was down to about $500,000. And they were in total panic. So what happened? They did everything they were supposed to do. And what I will tell you is that financial planning, the way it's taught today and the way it's utilized today, doesn't work. And they are a prime example. Hello, my name is Mike Bass. I'm a financial planner, and I have an office here in Altamont Springs, and I'm a certified financial planner, and I'm a certified investment manager analyst. I've been in the business quite a long time, and I got in this business because I was intrigued by the whole financial planning concept. Most people get in this business, they're interested in becoming investment advisors or they're life insurance salesmen, one or the other. I was intrigued by the whole concept of helping people navigate through the whole issue of financial planning and how to create the wealth they need to live the life they want to in the future. So I became licensed in this business and going through the educational process and then actually becoming a financial planner and meeting with clients. What I realized was is that this is primarily a sales business and that most of the people in this business were selling products. And they really weren't doing a comprehensive job of helping clients put financial planning together. Financial planning, unfortunately, when it's implemented the way it's taught in today's world, is really a concept of accumulating wealth and then amassing enough wealth on the table, basically, metaphorically speaking, the table, that you would have enough money to live off for the rest of your life. There used to be a company called ING years ago. They had a perfect commercial for this. And what they showed was they were asking people what their number was. And what they were asking people is how much money did they need to have to be able to retire so that they could comfortably live off the income of that. And I love that. I love that whole concept, what they were doing, because it was so wrong. Just by the example of what I gave you, the people in the beginning, trying to put money on a table, metaphorically on a table, mounting up an amount of wealth, and thinking you're going to live off the income for that for the rest of your life, usually doesn't work. And we're going to show you why that doesn't work. There's three main entities you have to be aware of that really prevents you from accumulating the type of wealth that most people want to accumulate. And strangely enough, it's the financial services industry itself. It's corporations that you buy products from, and it's also the government. Now, we need all three of those entities, but all three of those entities in doing what they do create roadblocks to stop you from creating the kind of wealth you need to create. And we talk about how to deal with those as we go forward here. What I want to start with tonight is what we call the circle of knowledge. So if you will let this circle represent all the knowledge that exists in the world. Fair enough? So there's parts of this circle of all the knowledge of the universe that you know to be true. You know your name. You know where you are. You know what you do for a living. You know the name of your mother and your father. There's things that you know that you know. Is that fair? And then there's things you know you don't know. Like for me, I know I can't do brain surgery. You don't want me doing brain surgery, right? Fair enough? So, and I unfortunately can't fly an airplane. I'd love to be able to fly an airplane, but you don't want me at the helm of an airplane because I don't know how to fly an airplane. So there's things we all know that we know we don't know. That leaves a huge segment of knowledge that's in our blind spot. Those are things you don't know that you don't know, okay? That is a huge amount of things. So how do you deal with that? Now, we don't need to know everything in the world, but there's things that we like to know. So how does that affect us, and how do we improve upon the things that we don't know? So there's three ways to expand on that. First one is the places you go, the experiences you have. When you go somewhere, you see things and learn things that you never knew before. Right out of college, I couldn't get a job. It was the middle of recession. A friend of mine and I, we traveled across the United States for about 4 months. I was amazed at the experiences and the people we met and the experiences we had, and things I would have never learned had I not done that. It's things you read. I read a very, very disturbing figure today, a couple days ago, about how few people read after they get out of high school and after they get out of college. It's really sad, because reading is one of the ways that we expand our knowledge base. And all the thoughts of the universe have been written down somewhere. And so it's great to expand our knowledge. Certainly a great way to do that. And finally, it's the people that we meet. Obviously, we all have had mentors and parents and friends and folks that we've met that have helped expand our knowledge base. So those are all important people in life. Now, that little red sliver that you see there, I think is the most dangerous. Obviously, the things we don't know can cause us problems. Is that fair? But if you don't know something, you will never act on something you don't know. But that little red sliver right there represents what I believe to be the most dangerous thing that happens to us in our circle of knowledge. And that represents the things that we know to be true that turn out not to be true. And the problem with that is that you won't act on things you don't believe, but you will only act on things that you believe. So even though it may not be true, you will still act on it if you believe it to be true. If you stood on the edge of a cliff and you believe that gravity didn't exist, that would be a rude awakening if you decide to jump on it. Fair enough? I mean, you would find out real quick that your knowledge base was, that your belief system was wrong. The reason I bring this up is that the three entities I just explained to you, the financial services industry, corporations, and the government, all tell you things that have led all of us to believe certain things about finances. And unfortunately, people tell you things that they want you to know. Fair enough? And it's from their perspective. What I'm going to tell you is that maybe all of that information isn't to your benefit. And we're going to explore some of that today with you. So now I want to take you through a little discussion about wealth and kind of how we see this a little differently than maybe most of the people you may find in this business. So I'd like to start with allowing this circle to represent your circle of wealth. And the one thing about everybody's circle of wealth, we all want our circle of wealth to grow. Is that fair? I mean, certainly we do. And you'll know some. You also know that some people's circle of wealth are bigger than yours, and some people's circle of wealth are smaller than yours. But we certainly all want it to grow. There's no question about it. So we talk about, with our clients, three types of money. And I want to just kind of hit on these to kind of get you to understand kind of what those monies are and what the purpose of those are. The first one I'm going to talk to you about is lifestyle money. When I got in this business, I thought it was my job to help clients do a budget and to help them quit spending money that they shouldn't spend, like going to Starbucks and spending $5 a day on Starbucks. So they could save all this money, and I would show them how much money they want to save and how much that would help them in the long run. I quickly found out that was not the place I wanted to be in life. Explaining to people how to change their lifestyle was not a very good place to engage people. So here's the deal. I promise you that we will not engage in that, in changing your lifestyle. I believe that you can do everything we need to do without changing lifestyle, quite frankly, in general. The second one is accumulated money. And accumulated money stands for all the money that you now have and all the money you have coming in. Now, interestingly enough, that's the focus that the financial services industry wants to focus on, because that's where they get paid. They get paid on the money you already have and the money that you've got coming on an ongoing basis. So that's where they're going to focus their attention to create wealth for you. And it sounds like it makes sense. The third one is unique to us and the people that I work with. And that we call this transferred money. And we're going to spend a good bit of time talking throughout the rest of this little presentation about transferred money. That's the money that you unknowingly and unnecessarily are transferring away that you don't have to, that you can be putting into creating more wealth for yourself rather than losing that money. And we'll spend a lot more time talking about that. So, again, this being your circle of wealth, if we look again at these transfers, these wealth transfers, what we notice is that when we transfer money away that we don't need to, is that we have what's called opportunity costs. And what that means is that for every dollar you acquire, you choose to spend it or invest it. You either do one of two things. You either spend it or you invest that money. Savings is an investment. Once those dollars, the dollars, invested dollars will grow over time, the money you spend goes away forever. It's gone. So, and I like the analogy of thinking about chickens. So if let's say for instance that chickens, if you got a chicken and you chicken grows up and you kill and eat the chicken, okay? You've not only lost that chicken at this point, but you've lost all the little chickens. This thing will grow forever. Well, that's exactly what happens with money that you spend. Let's say, for instance, you have somehow or another, you had $20,000 expense that you didn't need in your life. And you had an investment return of 5%. And over the next 15 years, what would that mean to you? Well, you would have lost the $20,000, obviously. But over the next 15 years, you would have also lost $22,274 of money that $20,000 would have grown. You would have had a total of $42,000, but you lost that because for some reason you had an expense that you didn't need. So opportunity costs are really important in understanding wealth transfers. So what are those wealth transfers? Well, this is the major categories we find wealth transfers. How we pay for our house, our mortgages. Obviously taxes. I mean, just think about it. If you paid the government several thousand dollars each year that you didn't need to pay, think about what that costs you. You're not gonna lose that money, but you've lost the money they would have grown to forever. And certainly none of us need to pay the government more taxes than they need. They don't do a very good job with it. I think we do a better job with it. Qualified plans, how do we save for retirement? Strangely enough, people are transferring money away in how we save for retirement. Protection, we're gonna spend a little more time talking about protection later. In other words, the insurances that we have, are we effectively, number one, are we effectively being insured? Number two is, are we doing that in an effective way from a cost standpoint as well? College funding. Those of you who may have to deal with sending children to college and how that happens, there are more efficient ways to send kids to college and economically. So we want to make sure we don't have transfers in it. And obviously any other major purchases like financing cars, how you deal with credit cards and trading cards and all those sorts of things. Those are where we see the major places that we have wealth transfers. So one of the things I try to help clients understand is that we now live in a very volatile world. I don't know if you recall what happened around 2000 and 2001. We had a catastrophic financial event. In fact, they told us it was about a 100-year financial event. You know, it was something unprecedented. Strangely enough, we had another one in 2008, 2009. Less than 10 years later, we had another catastrophic event. I would venture to say that we're probably in the midst of one right now. It could be worse, even worse than maybe some of those. We don't know yet because we don't really understand what's happened lately. But we certainly are in a downturn in the market right now. So the point of this is that volatility, the way things are moving, are going to change dramatically. They're going to continue to do that. So I want to put you in position where you have control of your own money. Remember those three entities I talked to you about? The financial institutions, the corporations, and the government? Well, these little icons represent all of those: mortgages, banks, credit cards, taxes, cars, big purses, those kind of things. All of these entities, when you interact with them, they want to be in control of your money. We don't realize how much control they take of our money. So everything we do, we want to be in a position where we have control. Number two, we want to be in a position that when things happen, we can react to those. So having use and control of your money, we believe, is very, very important.